Heavenly Father, we thank you for the Bible study tonight. We thank you because you brought us together so your blessings can be poured upon our lives. And we pray that all of us who are here tonight and all those who are hearing the word and we're learning together, none of us will go back home empty-handed in Jesus' name. Shower your blessings upon us. Grant us understanding. Grant us illumination. Oh, pray, Lord, oh, grant us the desire to be everything you want us to be in Jesus' name. Help us tonight to see you very clearly in the word and to see the provision you have made for us and to partake us of all the fullness of your blessing in our lives in Jesus' name. We thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Thank you very much. You can sit. And we're coming in a Bible study tonight to John chapter 7. We've been studying systematically in the Word of God. We're coming from John chapter 1, and we're now in chapter 7. Tonight we're looking at verses 32 all through to 39. John chapter 7, verse 32. The Pharisees said that the people murmured such things concerning him, that is concerning Christ. And the Pharisees and the chief priests sent officers to take him. Then said Jesus unto them, yet a little while am I with you, and then I go unto him that sent me. He shall seek me, and shall not find me. And where I am, thither ye cannot come. Then said the Jews among themselves, whither will he go, that we shall not find him? Will he go unto the dispersed among the Gentiles, or teach the Gentiles? What manner of saying is this, that he said, ye shall seek me, and shall not find me, and where I am, thither ye cannot come? In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. Verse 39, but they spake he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him shall receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. You find in verse 37, it says, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And then it goes on in verse 38 to say, he that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly, out of his spirit, out of his innermost part, shall flow rivers of living water. We're looking at the message tonight, rivers of living water for the thirsty. You bring verse 37 and verse 38 together. It says, if any man thirst, He's asking for those who are thirsty. And then he says, if you're thirsty and you come unto him, as he has appointed in the word, he says, there'll be rivers of living water flowing out of you and flowing to reach the lives of other people. This provision and this promise will be yours in Jesus' name. The provision of the well of living waters and the provision of the rivers of living water was made plain by Christ. He came that our thirst may be satisfied. He came that he'll provide the well of living waters, and he provides the spring of living waters, and in fact rivers of living waters, so that those who are thirsty, and those who are passionate, and those who are desirous, and those who are willing, and those who want the best from him, they'll be satisfied, and you will be a candidate for that satisfaction tonight in Jesus' name. We thirst after physical refreshing for normal water. We become thirsty. That's the way he has made us. He has created us with that thirst. And for refreshing or freshness, we also thirst after spiritual satisfaction. We don't have peace, we desire peace. We don't have joy, we desire joy. And even in relationship, we're thirsty for a better relationship. We're thirsty for his power. We're thirsty for complete inner strength. And our Lord Jesus Christ has provided the well of water. That means salvation. He has provided also the rivers of living water, which is the baptism in the Holy Ghost for those who are thirsty. And tonight, everything we need spiritually, everything we need according to his promised provision will be granted to us in Jesus' name. But you want to understand, he used the word river, he used the word river, he used the word living waters so as to demonstrate something spiritual. Look at John chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 14. John chapter 4, reading from verse 14. It says, but whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him. This Christ talking. This is our Savior talking. This is our Redeemer. This is the giver of salvation, the giver of eternal life. It says, whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into everlasting life. As he mentions everlasting life, you know he's talking about something spiritual. It's not talking about the water we drink every day, but he's saying, I have a kind of water, living water, that grants salvation, that grants eternal life. And when you drink that water, you'll not be thirsty for the dirty things of the world anymore. Look at Isaiah chapter 12. Isaiah chapter 12, reading from verse 2. It shows us the imagery or the picture of what he refers to as the water. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 12, verse 2. It says, behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and not be afraid. Then he goes on to say, for the Lord Jehovah is my strength and my song. He also has become my salvation. Look at verse 3. Therefore, with joy shall ye draw water out of the wells of salvation. So you understand, as he's talking about water spiritually, he's talking about water in the sense of eternal life, in the sense of salvation, in the sense of that which satisfies us spiritually, satisfies our spirit, our soul, our inner man, and that spiritual part of us. We're looking at Revelation chapter 22. Revelation chapter 22. So you understand the use of the language water, well of living waters, or the rivers of living water. We're looking at Revelation chapter 22, verse 17. And the Spirit and the bride say, come. And he that heareth, let him come. Let him that heareth come. And let him that is athirst come. You see, there must be that thirst in you. There must be that desire in you. And then it says, and whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. The water of life freely. It talks about salvation. When it talks about the water, it talks about living water. That means water of life, and that's about salvation. But then he also talks about the Holy Spirit. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 44. Now he's talking about rivers of living water. It's going beyond the well that he told that other woman and said, if you know the gift of God, if you knew the will of God, the gift of God, and he it is that speaks unto you, you'll ask him, he'll give you water, and then it will be water out of the well of his salvation. We're now coming to this, the rivers, rivers of living water. Isaiah chapter 44, we're looking at verse 3. Isaiah chapter 44, we're looking at verse 3. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty. All the time, he's saying that there must be those who are thirsty. There must be those who are passionate. There must be those who are desirous. There must be those who are not satisfied with who they are and what they are and where they are. And they want to have something greater, something higher, something richer, something refreshing, and something that gives them more satisfaction. That's why it talks about those who are thirsty. A person might, you know, come to the Bible study. A person might read the Bible. If there's no thirst, if there's no desire, I just came because others are coming. I just came because they told me to come. That nothing will happen. But when you come and there's something in you, and you know that you have a need, and that need, you know the provision of the water of life can supply. That need, you know that the provision, the promise of the rivers of living water can supply. And then you are passionate, you are desirous to say, Lord, I want something. I don't want to go away empty-handed. Those who are thirsty, something good will happen to them. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and my blessing upon thy offspring. You see, he's talking about water, and then he talks about my spirit, the Holy Spirit, the Holy Ghost, the Comforter, the Paraclete, the power of God in the believers. He says, I'll pour my spirit upon all flesh, and he calls that the water, the river of living waters. Look at Isaiah chapter 28. Isaiah chapter 28, I'm reading from verse 11. In Isaiah chapter 28, verse 11, it's talking about the refreshing that the water is going to give us, the refreshing that the Holy Ghost is going to give us, and the renewal, the revival that the Holy Ghost is going to bring in our soul. Isaiah chapter 28, I'm reading from verse 11. For with stammering lips and another tongue will he speak unto this people, to whom he said, this is the rest wherewith ye may cause the weary to rest. And this is the refreshing, yet they would not hear. This is the refreshing. When that water of life comes, when the rivers come, there'll be refreshing. There'll be renewal. And then there'll be revitalization in every one of our lives, because this is the desire of the Lord. And when your desire matches the desire of the Lord, when your passion matches the promise of the Lord, then those two things coming together. It's coming from God, a great desire to be a blessing to you. And it's coming from you here on earth, that you want everything that he has for you. Then there'll be that revival, renewal, and there'll be refreshing in every one of our lives. In Jesus' name, the Lord has made the provision, and he makes the provision number one for regeneration, that is for him to recreate you, to refashion you, to remold your life, and to transform your life. That is, salvation will come in, and a mighty change will come. Not only that, for renewal. You are getting cold, there'll be renewal. You are getting weary, there will be renewal. You are getting dry, there will be renewal. You are getting tired, there will be renewal. That provision is here tonight. It will come upon your life. And there is refreshing for all those who will come to Christ today, because he's a supplier of all our needs. He's a supplier of every spiritual need. He's a supplier of all our desires, spiritual, all our desires in every way. And because he's a supplier, and he's a sufficient. And he said, if you are thirsty, you can come. If you are desirous, you can come. If you need something deeper and greater and higher, overflowing than what you have now, there will be an outpouring. And he says, you can come. If any man thirst, let him come unto me and let him drink. Because the Holy Ghost is available. Because His power is available. Because that renewal is available. And as you claim the promise of the Lord tonight, it will be yes and amen in your life. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. And then in bracket it says, it explains so that you understand, this is talking about something spiritual. This is talking about something beyond the natural. It says, but they speak ye of the Spirit, which they that believe on him shall receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given at that time, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. Tonight, we're looking at this topic, rivers of living water for the thirsty. Rivers of living water for the thirsty. As we come back to John chapter 7, we divide this passage to three parts. Number one, from verses 32 to 36, and that is the opportunity for seekers of treasured blessings. The opportunity for seekers of treasured blessings. Blessings that you treasure, blessings that you appreciate, blessings that you count significant, and you're seeking for that, the opportunity is there. And Jesus Christ was telling them, while he was with them, they should seek the blessings of the Lord. While they had the opportunity, they should seek so that they will find, because he will soon be leaving them. He was telling them. Number two, the outpouring of the Spirit on thirsty believers. The outpouring of the Spirit on thirsty believers. The believers who are thirsty, and the believers who know that God has something greater than what they've got. And they can still move forward in the way of the Lord. They can still move forward in the experience of the Lord. There is the outpouring of the Spirit for believers who are thirsty. Number three now, the obedience of thirsty seekers for a transforming baptism. A transforming baptism. It's not a baptism that comes to you and lives you the way you are. It's a kind of baptism that transforms you. And that privilege is here tonight. And that privilege is available for those who are seeking the Lord with all their heart, all their soul, all their mind, so that the blessings of God will be theirs, the blessing will be yours. Number one, the opportunity for seekers of treasured blessings. We're coming to chapter 7 of John, reading from verse 32. The Pharisees heard that the people murmured such things concerning him, and the Pharisees and the chief priests sent officers to take him. What were they murmuring? The people were saying quietly between themselves. They said, this must be the Christ. This is that prophet. They said, what other things will he do? What other miracle are we expecting? This is the Christ. Do the rulers actually know that this is the Christ? And the Pharisees heard that this is what the people were saying. Look at verse 31. And many of the people believed on him and said, when Christ cometh, will he do more miracles than these that this man has done? That was the thing they were talking about among themselves. And the Pharisees said that, and they sent officers that they should take him and bring him, because they wanted to stop all those things that the people were discussing among themselves. But then Jesus Christ revealed the opportunities they had that they ought to take care of, and it ought to take heed about. Look at verse 33. Then said Jesus unto them, yet a little while am I with you, and then I go unto him that sent me. He has spent much of his ministry, and he has spent some years teaching them and being with them, providing for all their spiritual and physical needs. And now he said, you just have a little while now, a little time now. Actually, between this time and the crucifixion was about 6 months. That's why he said, just a little while, and then I go to him that sent me. Look at verse 34. He shall seek me, and ye shall not find me. He was saying, I will go to my Father, and I'll be coming to your temples, and coming to your synagogues, and coming on the streets, and coming to the mountainside, and I've been teaching, revealing the will of God to you. At that time you'll be searching for me, and you will see whatever you need for me. You'll not see me at that time in the physical. That's why he said, he shall seek me and shall not find me, and where I am, thither ye cannot come. He was talking about going to the Father. Going to the Heavenly Father. He was talking about going to heaven. And then they said among themselves, whither will he go, that we shall not find him? Will he go unto the dispersed among the Gentiles and teach the Gentiles? Does he mean he's going to leave us in Jerusalem? Going to leave us in Capernaum? Going to leave us in all the Jewish places? And then he will go to the Gentiles and teach them, and then we cannot come to him where he is going? They misunderstood everything he said. And many people today, they misunderstand, and they think, okay, this is what they have said and this is what they mean. And because they misunderstand, that's why they miss the opportunity of seeking the blessings they ought to receive from the Lord. Look at verse 36. What manner of saying is this that he said, he shall seek me and shall not find me? He shall seek me and shall not find me. He was telling them that this was the day of opportunity, the time of opportunity. That's why he said, he shall seek me and shall not find me, and where I am, thither ye cannot come. Many of those Jews and many of those Pharisees or the scribes, they had a great opportunity at that time to seek and to find the things that Jesus Christ has brought from heaven. He came with salvation, the opportunity of seeking and finding that and receiving that. He came with the blessings of heaven. The greatest of blessings from heaven were available, and yet they did not seek him. Many of them lost the opportunity, and they did not see the goodness in Christ and the grace of Christ and the glory of Christ. They did not see the salvation that Jesus Christ brought. There are many people today, they seem religious. They read the Bible. They go to their churches. They come to our church as well. And yet they cannot see that salvation. They cannot see that eternal life. They cannot see what he came to give unto us. Those people did not seek eternal life. They did not seek heavenly righteousness in Christ. Light came to them. They remained in darkness. Power came to them. They remained in weakness. And the truth came to them, and they remained in error. Salvation came to them, and they remained in their sin. Heaven was so near, and yet they chose hell. In fact, we are told about the Pharisees, that these Pharisees, instead of receiving the salvation he brought, they even hindered other sinners from receiving that salvation that they could have received. Look at Matthew chapter 15. Matthew chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 12. Salvation was near, they were not saved. The blessings of God were near, they were not blessed. And the riches of heaven came so near to them, yet they did not receive. I pray as the salvation of the Lord is near and getting nearer and nearer, giving us understanding, you receive in Jesus' name. But look at these Pharisees, Matthew chapter 15, we're reading from verse 12. Then came his disciples and said unto him, knowest thou that the Pharisees were offended after they had this saying? How can that be? He was talking about salvation. They were offended. He talked about righteousness. They were offended. He talked about the goodness he brought from heaven. They were offended. He talked about repentance. He spoke to them on how they can have the blessings of God coming to their lives and reaching their lives. And they were offended. Look at what Jesus said in verse 13. But he answered and said, every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted shall be rooted up. In verse 14, let them alone. Pharisees, let them alone. False prophets, let them alone. False teachers, let them alone. The people that hear the word of God, they are offended, let them alone. The people that hear the word of God, seek me at this time. Seek the righteousness of God at this time. And they refuse to seek, and they are offended, leave them alone. They be blind leaders of the blind. And if the blind lead the blind, both shall fall into the ditch. He's talking about those Pharisees. I pray you'll not be among that number. Matthew chapter 23, I'm reading from verse 13. Matthew chapter 23, Reading from verse 13. It says in verse 13, "But woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites." These were people that hypocritically they will say they were following the Lord, and yet they will not seek the Lord. They will not seek his face. They will not seek his righteousness. They will not seek his salvation. They will even hinder the people that are trying to seek, and the people that want the salvation, and the people that want the goodness, and the people that want that eternal life, they will hinder them. That's why Jesus said, "Hypocrites, Pharisees, and scribes, for ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men." Look at that. "Ye shut up the kingdom of heaven against men, for ye neither go in yourselves, neither suffer ye them that are entering to go in." They forbade the people that wanted eternal life, and they said they were looking for anybody that will confess him, anybody that will accept him, anybody that will believe him. They were going to deal ruthlessly and negatively against such people. We're looking at Luke chapter 11. Luke chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 52. Luke chapter 11, reading from verse 52. Here it tells us, "Woe unto you lawyers," still Pharisees and Sadducees and the scribes, these people were the people that said they could interpret the word of God to the people, and their interpretation was turning people away from the blessings of the Lord. "Woe unto you lawyers, for ye have taken away the key of knowledge." You have taken away the key of knowledge. That is, they took away the proper interpretation of the word of God. And they told the people, "We are the only people that can interpret the word unto you. Don't go to any other source." About Christ, they said, "Forget Christ." About his salvation, "Forget his salvation." About the water of life, "Forget all that." About the rivers of living water, "Forget about that." But we are the people that can make known unto you the might of God. And in doing that, they took away the key of knowledge. "Ye entered not in yourselves." They didn't have salvation. You couldn't find the evidence of salvation, eternal life in them. They didn't enter into the treasured blessings that Jesus Christ brought. It says, "Ye entered not in yourselves, and them that were entering in ye hindered." We're coming back to John chapter 7. We'll see the attitude of those Pharisees, the attitude of those scribes, and attitudes of those people that should have encouraged the people to listen to Christ, and they should have encouraged the people to have whatever Christ has brought to them. And now Jesus is telling, goes beyond the Pharisees now, and he goes beyond all those Jewish leaders. He comes to the people. Look at verse 33, John chapter 7. They said, Jesus said unto the people, "Yet a little while I am with you." Yet a little while am I with you. You want to get healing from me? Yet a little while am I from you. With you. You want to get salvation from me? Yet am I a little while with you. You're seeking for peace of mind and rest in your soul. Yet am I a little while with you. You're looking for satisfaction. Yet am I a little while with you. You're looking for heavenly blessing, and you're looking for a place in heaven. "Yet am I a little while with you, and then I go unto him that sent me." If you're going to seek, seek it now. If you're going to search, search for it now. If you're going to receive, receive it now. If you're going to be blessed, this is the time to be blessed, because in verse 34, "You shall seek me. If it becomes too late, you shall seek me and shall not find me. And where I am, thither ye cannot come." He was telling them that this was the time they ought to seek the Lord. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 55. Isaiah chapter 55, and I'm reading from verse 6. Isaiah chapter 55, we're reading from verse 6. The Lord was telling them, "Do the right thing at the right time, and seek the Lord for the right thing at the right time." Look at Isaiah chapter 55, verse 6. It says, "Seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near." That's exactly what Christ was telling them. "I'm still with you. Salvation is here. I'm still with you. Healing, deliverance are here. I'm still with you. Eternal life is here. I'm still with you. The blessings of heaven are here. here and still with you, the fulfillment of all the promises of God can be made available now. Therefore, you seek ye the Lord while he may be found. Call ye upon him while he's near. Let the wicked forsake his way and the righteous man his thoughts, and let him return, let him return, let him return unto the Lord, and he will have mercy upon him and to our God, for he will abundantly pardon. He will pardon those who seek the Lord. He will forgive those who seek the Lord. He'll give eternal life to those who seek the Lord. We're looking at Hosea, Hosea chapter 10. Hosea chapter 10 is telling us what we need to seek, and seek that now. It's telling us the thing we're searching for, and search for it now. It's telling us what we should be asking the Lord, and we should be asking now at this time of opportunity. Hosea chapter 10. And verse 12, sow to yourselves in righteousness and reap in mercy. Break up your fallow ground. Sometimes the heart is dull. Sometimes the heart is dry. Sometimes the heart is resistant. And you say, well, my kind of heart is like, I don't feel like praying. I say, break up your fallow ground. I don't feel like seeking the Lord. Now break up your fallow ground, because this is your chance. This is your opportunity. And do not allow the opportunity to pass you by. Sow to yourselves in righteousness. Forget about other people. Forget about other concerns. And think about yourself. And think about your destiny. And think about your eternal life. And think about your future. And sow to yourselves in righteousness. Reaping mercy. Break up your fallow ground. For it is time to seek the Lord. It is time to seek the Lord till he come and rain righteousness upon you. He will do it. Because a time was coming, Christ was telling them that they will seek and they will not find. And I pray that you'll not wait for such a time in Jesus' name. Was that something different from what the prophets of the Old Testament had told them? No, the same thing they had told them, because they had told them, it's available now, seek him. Salvation available now, seek that. Righteousness available now, seek that. Because a time will come when you seek for that word, when you seek for that wonder, when you seek for that blessing, and you'll not find. Amos chapter 8, I'm reading from verse 11. Amos chapter 8, reading from verse 11. Behold, the days come, says the Lord, that I will send a famine in the land, not a famine of bread, nor a thirst for water, but of hearing the words of the Lord. The words of life eternal, words of salvation, words of faith, words of power, and words of total provision, and words of the provision of the Lord coming from heaven, and words supernatural that will bring the wonders of the Lord upon your life. The prophet Amos was telling them, he said, you're going to seek it now, seek it now. You're seeking righteousness, seek for that now. You're seeking for the goodness of God, seek for that now, because the time is coming when there'll be a famine of hearing the word of the Lord. Look at verse 12. And they shall wander from sea to sea, and from the north even to the east, and they shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord, to seek the word of life, to seek the word of eternal life, to seek the word of his grace, and to seek the word of his power. He said the time will come, they'll go to the east, and they'll go to the west, and the north, and from sea to sea, and he shall run to and fro to seek the word of the Lord. Tell me the last part of verse 12. And shall not find it. And shall not find it. You know, suddenly they wake up and they say, eternal life looks like we need eternal life. Eternal life looks like Jesus Christ can provide eternal life. Where is he? Is he in Jerusalem? No, he's not there. He's gone back to heaven. That's why I was telling them, seek that now. And seek it with all your heart and all your soul and all your mind. And you seek it with faith. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11, and I'm reading from verse 6. Hebrews chapter 11. Reading from verse 6, but without faith, it's impossible to please him. While Christ was available, they should believe on him. While Christ was near to them, they should have faith in him, and they should seek the blessings of the Lord from him with faith. For without faith, it's impossible to please him. For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of them them that diligently seek him. Diligently seek him. Wholeheartedly seek him. Passionately seek him. Faithfully seek him. Fervently seek him. He wants us to seek him right now at this time for the blessings we treasure and for the blessing that he himself as promised. That's why Jeremiah tells us in chapter 29, Jeremiah chapter 29, reading from verse 12, Jeremiah chapter 29, reading from verse 12, it says, then shall ye call upon me, and ye shall go and pray unto me, and I will hearken unto you. Any amen coming from the house? Look at verse 13, and ye shall seek me. Look at this, and ye shall seek me and find me when ye shall search for me. How? With all your heart. Ye shall search for me with all your heart. And Jesus was saying to those people, to those Jewish people, if you're going to seek this at the time, if you're going to have this at the time, if you're going to pray this at the time, if you're going to lean on him, rely on him this at the time, if you're going to claim the blessings of the Lord that are made for you and promised for you, said this at the time, because the time will come when you will seek and then you will not find. We're coming to point number two now. This is the outpouring of the Spirit on thirsty believers. The outpouring of the Spirit on thirsty believers. We're coming to chapter 7. And we're coming to verse 37. John chapter 37. We're reading from chapter 7, verse 37. It says, in the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Look at that. It says, in the last day, that great day of the feast. Let me remind you that they were celebrating the feast of tabernacles. Look at verse 2, chapter 7, and in verse 2. Now, the Jews' feast of tabernacle was at hand. The Jews' feast of tabernacles was at hand. Look at verse 14. Now about the midst of the feast, Jesus went up into the temple and taught. And the feast took place for about 7 days. And they have been hearing the word of God, hearing the word of God. And yet, they had not received life eternal. He had been teaching them the word, because we are told in the midst of the feast, within those 7 days, he appeared in the temple and he taught them. And now, the great day, the last day of the feast, Jesus said, you have had a lot, you've read a lot, you've listened to a lot, I've explained a lot to you, I've taught you a lot. Now, if you're going to receive the blessing of God, there must be thirst. If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. It was shifting the attention away from the Pharisees. Don't go to them. It was shifting their attention away from the high priest. Don't go to him. It was shifting the attention away from the people that were sacrificing. Don't go to them. If you're thirsty, if you want the blessings of heaven, if you want the salvation of God, and if you want the goodness of God, which he has provided for this time, he says, let him come unto me and drink. The Lord had taught them the word, but hearing the word in concentrated form was a great privilege, and yet that was not enough. There must be thirst for you to benefit. There must be thirst, there must be desire for you to receive the blessing of the word. It's wonderful to come to the Bible study, but there must be thirst in you. It's wonderful to come to a Sunday worship, but there must be thirst and passion, desire in you. It's wonderful for us to come at the third weekend revival, and then we're hearing the word of God, the Savior's touch. But you know what? You have to desire, you have to thirst, and you have to be passionate about it, that I'm going to get something. Thank God you are going to get something. Wonderful to come to the Congress, and wonderful to come to the conference, and wonderful to come to the retreat. But you know, it's not just hearing the word. If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. Thirst is very important. I'm coming back to Isaiah again, and I'm reading from chapter 44, and I'm reading from verse 3. Isaiah chapter 44, reading from verse 3. It tells us in chapter 44, verse 3, I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, I will pour water, not just on everybody. The promises of God are there for everyone. Salvation for everyone. Sanctification for everyone. And the baptism in the Holy Ghost for everyone. Power for everyone. Help for everyone. Release for everyone. Refreshing for everyone. But those who are thirsty, those are the people that are going to receive. For I will pour water upon him that is thirsty, and floods upon the dry ground. I will pour my spirit upon thy seed, and blessings upon thy offspring. It tells us in Isaiah chapter 55. Isaiah chapter 55. I'm reading here from verse 1. Thirst. Thirst is very important. It says, oh, everyone that thirsteth, come ye to the waters. You see that? It says, there must be thirst. There must be that desire in you, and he invites you. He says, as you are thirsty, then come. Come to the waters, and then you'll fill your soul to overflowing in Jesus' name. Matthew chapter 5, we're looking at verse 6. Matthew chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 6. Thirst is very important. And you know the reason why people know in their head about salvation and they're not saved? There's no thirst. They know about sanctification, they are not sanctified. You know why? Because there's no thirst. They know about righteousness, they are not righteous. You know why? They're not thirsty. They know about a better life, a richer life, a holy life, a heavenly life, and they don't have that kind of life. You know why? There's no thirst in them. It is when the thirst is there, then the Lord says, it will satisfy the thirsty soul, it will satisfy you tonight. Look at chapter 5 of Matthew. Matthew chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 6. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. Somebody says, I go to a church where they preach a sanctification. That's true. You go to a church where they preach sanctification, are you thirsty? I go to a church where they preach righteousness, and they mention it every time, holiness without which no man shall see the Lord. Yes, we do every time. Are you holy? And have you got that experience that prepares you to heaven? No, you have not got if you are not thirsty, because it says, blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness. They hunger and thirst after righteousness. They hunger and thirst after holiness. They hunger and thirst after the divine nature. They hunger and thirst after that experience the Lord himself has promised. He said, blessed are those people. They're only blessed. Why? Because they're thirsty. Because they're hungry, because they're desirous. And it says, blessed are they that which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. I pray that that satisfaction will be yours in Jesus' name. And you'll have the thirst, you'll have the passion, you'll have the desire to have everything the Lord has prepared for you. And then he goes to the very last chapter of the Bible, in Revelation chapter 22, and he's still talking about water of life available for those who are thirsty. He's talking about eternal life available for those who are thirsty. He's talking about the abundant life for those who are thirsty. He's talking about a spiritual life for those who are thirsty, only for those who are thirsty. That's why he tells us in chapter 22 of Revelation. Revelation chapter 22, and I'm reading here from verse 16. I, Jesus, have sent mine angel to testify unto you these things in the churches. I am the root and the offspring of David, and the bright and the morning star. Listen to this now. And the spirit and the bright say, come. And let him that heareth say, come. And let him that is athirst come. Let him that is athirst come. The one who is thirsty. The one who says, I cannot do without this. I cannot do without this water of life. I cannot do without this river of living water. Let him that thirst come, and whosoever will, let him take of the water of life freely. I pray you will have it in Jesus' name. But he says, as we come back to John chapter 7. John chapter 7. What are you reading from verse 37? In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried. He cried aloud so that nobody will say, Did he say that? I didn't hear that. Maybe he talked with such a low tone of voice that I didn't hear. No, everybody will hear this. And he said, he stood and he cried, saying, if any man, this is available for anyone, but there you must be thirsty. If any man come, if any man thirst, let him come unto Peter. Let him come unto Mary. Let him come unto who? Tell me out aloud. Let him come unto me and drink. Is it because Jesus is the Savior? Not Jesus and Mary, and not Jesus and Peter, and not Jesus and Paul, and not Jesus and the founder of your church, not Jesus and a religious man, not Jesus and another personality, Jesus and Jesus alone. If any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. You see that word drink is telling us something there, and he said that we shall come unto him. Come unto him. Look at Matthew chapter 11. Matthew chapter 11. I'm reading from verse 28. Matthew chapter 11 from verse 28 is invited us to the one that can satisfy all the spiritual needs of our lives. It says in Matthew chapter 11 verse 28, come unto me, come unto me, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. The rest who have in salvation is the one that can give us, he says, come unto me. And the rest we have as well, victory over temptation, victory over Satan, and victory over sin, is the one that can give that rest. You're in a combat, you're in a trial, your temptations, they're coming from here and there, and you're looking for strength so that you will overcome. If you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, you'll overcome in Jesus' name. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor, you're struggling, you're striving. How can I have the victory? All you that are heavy laden, and he says, and I will give you rest. You're looking for assurance, you're looking for peace of mind. He says, I've been religious, I've been looking for this and that, but you know what? I'm looking for peace of mind. I'm looking for rest in my soul. I do not have the assurance that if I died now, I will go to heaven. He says, then you can come unto me. He says, come unto me, all ye that labor and that are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It's the one that gives us inner satisfaction and inner contentment. If there is a turmoil inside, if there's confusion inside, if there's insecurity inside, and you're wondering, can somebody have assurance? Can somebody have contentment? Can somebody be so sure that he's sure that he's sure that no matter what happens, if Christ came today, I'll be going with him? It says, if you don't have that assurance, if you don't have rest in your soul, if you don't have peace in your mind, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. It's also talking about purity of heart. You want to come to him so that you can have that purity of heart, so that all the things that trouble you on the inside and that gives you doubt, with this in my heart, with this in my spirit, with this in my secret life, would I be able to make it when I eventually finish here? The Lord is saying, if you want to make it, you want to rest, you want to bring all those confusion, all the confusion and all the conflict within to an end, he says, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. He'll give us rest. All the possessions of heaven, he will give unto us. And the possession of the divine nature, he will give unto us. Now he's inviting us for power, for the fullness, and the baptism in the Holy Spirit. And he says, come unto me. As you come, he'll give you all this that he has promised in Jesus' name. And he gives us the assurance in John chapter 6. John chapter 6. I'm reading from verse 35. John chapter 6. We're looking at verse 35. It tells us in verse 35, it says, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me, you see that? He that cometh to me, that's the person you are to come to. That's the Savior, you are to come to him. That's the sanctifier, you are to come to him. That's the baptizer in the Holy Ghost, you are to come to him. That's a healer, you are to come to him. That's a deliverer, that's a redeemer. It says, I'm the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger, And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. Look at verse 37. All that the Father giveth to me shall come unto me. And him that cometh to me, I will in no wise cast out. He's waiting for you. As you come, he'll not push you away. As you come, he'll not drive you away. As you come, he's going to grant you all that you are seeking for from him, all that he has promised in Jesus' name. The fullness of blessing, the fullness of his riches, the fullness of heaven, he brings upon our soul. He gives us as we call upon him. We're looking at Psalm 36. Psalm 36, I'm reading from verse 8 and verse 9. Psalm 36, we're reading from verse 8. Psalm 36, reading from verse 8. Psalm 36, reading from verse 8, it says, they shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of thy house. A satisfaction is here tonight. In feeling is here tonight. The fullness of the Lord is here tonight. It'll satisfy you in Jesus' name. It says, they shall be abundantly satisfied with the fatness of his house. Then he goes on to say, and thou shalt make them drink. You see that? Thou shalt make them drink. Thou shalt make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. That's why it says, if anybody thirsts, if any man thirsts, if any believer thirsts, if any saved soul is there, and you're thirsty for more of God, and you're thirsty for more of heaven, and you're thirsty for more of the blessings of God, and you're thirsty for more and higher, greater experiences in Christ. That's why he says, if any man thirsts, let him come unto me and drink. He says, and I shall make them drink of the river of thy pleasures. For with thee is the fountain of life, and in thy light shall they see, shall we see light. In thy light shall they see light. You see light today. And you see abundance of the blessings of the Lord upon your life tonight in Jesus' name. Now we come to point number 3, the obedience of thirsty seekers for a transforming baptism. The obedience of thirsty seekers for a transforming baptism. We're coming back to John chapter 7. John chapter 7. And I'm reading from verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. And then he tells us in verse 38, he that believeth on me, as the scripture said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. For they speak he, but they speak he of the Spirit, which they that believe on him shall receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given, because that Jesus was not yet glorified. We need to understand what Jesus was talking about. He was talking about having the Spirit of God in the fullest of measures. It's not talking about being born again of the Spirit. That has happened already. It's not talking about sanctification here now, because that should have happened already before you come to this. It's talking about the rivers flowing from your innermost being and then reaching out to the people around you. Look at chapter 14 of John. John chapter 14, as he expatiates and expands and expounds on this understanding of the Spirit of God coming upon us in that baptismal measure. He tells us in John chapter 14, and he's talking about it in verse 15. He says, if ye love me, keep my commandments. If ye love me, keep my commandments. He's talking to believers. Unbelievers cannot keep the commandments of the Lord. Is talking to those who are saved already. Look at verse 16 now. And I will pray the Father, and he shall give you another comforter, that he may abide with you for how long? Forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive. Those who are worldly cannot receive him, and those who are still having all the pollutions of the world and all the pattern of the practice of the world, they cannot receive him. All the people that are going into the error of the world and the foul evil things in the world, this baptism is not for them. It says even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, but because it sees him not, neither knows him, but she know him, for he dwelleth with you. They were saved already. He dwelleth with you. They were born again already. He dwelleth with you. They were children of God already, but now, and shall be in you. It was a subsequent experience. It was a higher experience. It was a greater experience. Look at verse 26. In verse 26, it tells us, it says, but the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. They've not got it yet. Will send in my name. They were saved already. Therefore, this one is different from salvation. And was going to pray for the sanctification even before getting to the cross. And this is different from sanctification. It says there's a Comforter now. It's the Holy Ghost, whom the Father will send in my name. He shall teach you all things. He shall teach you all things. Salvation is to give us forgiveness. And then sanctification is to give us purity of heart. But this one is to make the teacher resident within us. Is to make the teacher dwell within us. Is to make the author of the word of God live inside us. So that when we read the Bible, he will interpret that word unto us. He says he shall teach you all things. And will bring all things, will bring all things to your remembrance. Whatsoever I have said unto you. There are people that tell us they are baptized in the Holy Ghost, and they're filled with the Holy Ghost, and they're immersed in the Holy Ghost, and all they think about is speaking in tongues. Yes, that's an initial evidence. But you know, here, when that Comforter comes, when that Holy Ghost comes, he lives inside you. It's your comfort. It's your Comforter. And because it's your comfort, your Comforter, he abides within you. When you have any problem, he speaks from within and comforts you. There are people that say they have the Holy Ghost and they speak in tongues, and then when they have problem, they are confused. They don't know what to do. Some of them were even told they go to hurt themselves and they want to kill themselves. And they don't have the Comforter within them. When you have the Holy Ghost resident within you, it's a Comforter. And it comforts you every time in a way that no man, no woman, no neighbor can comfort you. And then it says, he will teach you all things, teach you all things, teach you all things. The people that say they have the Holy Ghost are going to false doctrine. They don't have the Holy Ghost, because of the Spirit of truth. If the Spirit of truth is there, he will teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you. I pray it will happen. Chapter 15, I'm reading from verse 26. Chapter 15, verse 26, but when the Comforter is come, whom I will send to you from the Father, even the Spirit of truth, which proceedeth from the Father, he will testify of me. He'll be talking about Jesus to you. He'll talk about all the qualities of Christ unto you, all the attributes of Christ unto you, all the power of Christ unto you, all the goodness, the grace of Christ unto you, all the glories of Christ unto you. There are people that say they have the Holy Ghost and they don't know much about Christ. But he says when that Holy Ghost is come, that the Father will send unto you, he'll be telling you every day another area of the life of Christ, attribute of Christ, and the characteristics of Christ. He'll testify of me, and ye also shall bear witness, because ye have been with me from the beginning. I'm looking at chapter 16 in John chapter 16. I'm reading here from verse 7. Nevertheless, I tell you the truth. It is expedient that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you. If I go not away, the Comforter shall not come unto you. Look up here for a moment. You know, Jesus Christ had been with them. He solved all their problems, and he gave them all the answers to their questions. And it was a great privilege for them to be with the Lord Jesus Christ. When somebody has been so helpful and so loving, and his soul is their benefactor, is their shepherd, it's all in all for them, and then he's taken away, the sorrow would have been unbearable. But now the Comforter comes and is comforting them. It says it's expedient for you, it's profitable for you, it's better for you that I go away. If I go not away, the Comforter will not come. It says, but if I depart, I will send him unto you. There are some people that have lost loved ones, and you know, for a year, for 2 years, for 3 years, for 7 years, for 10 years, they're still sorrowful, and they're still mourning, and they say they have the Holy Ghost, and all these 7 years and 10 years the Holy Ghost has not comforted them. It says when that Holy Ghost comes, he'll be the comforter inside you. He'll be the comforter. He'll tell you it's the greater one is inside you, and the person you are sorrowful about has gone to heaven, and since he has gone to heaven, you're going to meet him. Just stay true here and faithful here, and on that final day you'll be together in Jesus' name. Look at this in verse 8, and when he is come, he'll reprove the world of sin. When the Holy Ghost comes through you and from inside you, he'll reprove the world of sin. You see, there are people, they say they have the Holy Ghost and sin is rampant around them, and sin is being committed around them. They cannot talk, they will not talk, because they don't really have the power of the Holy Ghost. So you have the power of the Holy Ghost, you begin sin, you fight against sin, you speak against sin, and the fire within you will burn, and you tell people how to come out of sin and come to the Savior. And then it says of righteousness and of judgment, of sin because they believe not on me, of righteousness because I go to my Father and you see me no more, of judgment because the prince of this world is judged. Look at verse 12. I have yet many things to say unto you, but ye cannot bear them now. How be it, when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. You see what we are missing? If you don't have the power of the Holy Ghost, the presence of the Holy Ghost with you, if you don't have this abiding revelation of the Holy Ghost with you, you're missing quite a lot. It says when you are baptized in the Holy Ghost, this is what he will do. It's not just speaking in tongues. It says, how be it when he, the Spirit of truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak, and he shall show you things to come. He'll show you things to come. I said he'll show you things to come. And then he says, and he shall glorify me. He'll glorify the Lord in your life. For he shall receive of mine and show it unto you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore said I that he shall take up mine and shall show it unto you. That's the promise he has given us. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 4. Acts chapter 1, we're reading from verse 4. And being assembled together with them, commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. They've heard of him in John chapter 7. They heard of him in John chapter 14. They heard of him in John chapter 15. They heard of him in John chapter 16. And now he says, as they assembled with them and they assembled with him, he said they must wait now for the promise of the Father. They must tarry for the promise of the Father. It's not just to hear the word of God, it's not just to learn about the teaching on the Holy Ghost. He said they should tarry, they should wait, and wait for the promise of the Father, which says he, ye have heard of me. Look at this in verse 5. For John truly baptized with water, but he shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. I pray it will happen. I said, I pray it will happen. When it happens, what's going to be the result of the evidence in their lives? Look at verse 8. But he shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you. I want you to remember that when Jesus Christ was on earth, in Matthew chapter 10, he gave them power and authority over demons and over sicknesses, that they will go and heal the sick and cast out devils. I want you to remember that for those 70 disciples, believers, he gave them the power to go and authority to go and deliver the oppressed and set the captives free. And they came back and they said, even the devils are subject unto us through thy name. And yet now he said, there's a higher power, there's a greater power, there's a broader and there's a deeper kind of power you're going to receive when the Holy Ghost comes upon you. You see, there are people, they just talk about the Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, Holy Ghost, and when we're looking at the evidence, maybe they spoke some words was in another language at that time, and then since that time they repeat that same thing, they repeated that same thing, and then they are satisfied. But it says this Holy Ghost baptism we're talking about, when it's come, it says, and you shall receive power after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses unto me both in Jerusalem and in all Judea and in Samaria and to the uttermost part of the earth. I pray it will happen to you. I said it will happen to you. Say it will happen to me. Look at John now. We're coming back to John. We're coming back to John chapter 7. John chapter 7. And I'm reading here from verse 37. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. He says, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. I want you to underline that word, drink. It's telling us that when you drink, if the water is there and you don't drink, satisfaction will not be there. I know about the water. If you don't drink, just knowing about the water will not grant you satisfaction. I know about, and I can even describe how the water is. You know, if you don't drink, there'll be no satisfaction. But he says, if anybody thirst, it's not just to hear about the water, it's not just to learn about the water, it's not just to analyze the water, it's not just to teach about the water, it's not just to take notes about the water. It says, if you're going to have satisfaction, if you're going to have renewal, if you're going to have refreshing, if you're going to have this internal rest and peace within you, if the power is going to come unto you, it says, let him come unto me and tell me the word and drink. I'm going to break it down for you so that you understand what it means, because you cannot just come now. The Holy Ghost is not inside a cup that I can give you, inside a glass I can give you, and then you drink. What does he mean by that? He's talking about something spiritual. D means to desire. D means to desire. You desire. R means to renew. You renew. And then I, you increase. N, neglect not. K, keep. D, desire the power of the Spirit. Desire the power of the Spirit. Without desire, you will not come. Without thirst, you will not come. If you are satisfied the way you are, I speak in tongues, and then all the other evidences are not there, and then you are satisfied, you will not come. You'll say, it's talking to the rest of the people. It's talking to those other people. Me, I already have this. But it's telling you, if any man thirsts, you want more than what you've got, and you want something deeper, greater, higher, broader than what you've got. He says there must be desire. We're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 14. I'm reading from verse 1. It says, follow after charity and desire spiritual gifts. Desire the gift of the Spirit, because the promise is unto you and to your children and to them that are far off, even as many as the Lord our God shall call. Desire. Colossians chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 9. Colossians chapter 1, verse 9, for this cause also we, since the day we heard it, do not cease to pray for you, and to desire that ye might be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. There must be that desire in you. I want revelation of the Spirit, the renewal of the Spirit, the power of the Spirit, the glory of Christ to be revealed unto me. I want that so much. And as you desire, the Lord will do it. I said, as you desire, the Lord will do it. Mark chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 22. And Jesus answering says unto them, have faith in God. For verily I say unto you, that whosoever shall say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and be thou cast into the sea, and shall not doubt in his heart, but shall believe that those things which he says shall come to pass, he shall have, what will he have? He shall have whatsoever he says. Verse 24, therefore I say unto you, what things soever ye desire. Do you desire tonight? I said, do you desire tonight? What things soever ye desire, when ye pray, believe that ye have them, ye receive them, and ye shall have them. D, what does D stand for? R, renew the purity in true sanctification. The Holy Spirit is holy. The Holy Spirit will not dwell in a place that is not clean, in a place that is defiled, in a place that is dirty. And therefore you have been saved, you have been sanctified. Then you renew the purity in true sanctification. That's why Jesus prayed for them to be sanctified before they were baptized in the Holy Ghost. Renew that purity. Renew that purity in true sanctification. I'm reading from John chapter 17. John chapter 17. We're reading from verse 17. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Sanctify them through thy truth. Thy word is truth. Verse 20. Neither pray I for these alone, but for them also which shall believe on me through their word, that they all may be one, as thou, Father, art in me, and I in thee, and that they also may be one in us, that the world may believe that thou hast sent me. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 25. Ephesians chapter 5. We're reading from verse 25. Ephesians chapter 5, reading from verse 25. Renew the purity in true sanctification. Here he tells us in verse 25, husbands, love your wives, even as Christ also loved the church and gave himself for it, that he might sanctify and cleanse it. That he might sanctify and cleanse it, or the washing of water by the word, that he might present it to himself a glorious church, not having spot or wrinkle or any such thing, but that it should be holy and without blemish. Renew the purity in true sanctification. I, increase your prayer and supplication. Increase your prayer and supplication. You want the power of the Holy Ghost. You want the revelation of the Holy Ghost. You want the promise of the Holy Ghost to be fulfilled in you. You'll not be praying as you were praying before. You'll not just limit yourself to the same thing you always say in prayer and the same sentences you always mention. Now you want something new. You want something deep. You want something greater. You want something higher. Increase your prayer and supplication. We're looking at Luke chapter 11. In Luke chapter 11, Luke chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 13. Luke chapter 11, verse 13, here it tells us, if ye then, being evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more shall your heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to them that do what? To them that do what? Them that ask him. As we're going to receive the power of the Holy Ghost, we'll not just, you know, stand up there and fold our hands and close our mouth and say, Holy Ghost, well, when you come, visit me too, I am here. You increase your prayer and you increase your supplication. Acts of the Apostles chapter 1. In Acts of the Apostles chapter 1, reading from verse 4, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them that they should not depart from Jerusalem, but wait for the promise of the Father, which saith he, ye have heard of me. For John truly baptized with water, but ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. Ye shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days hence. In verse 8, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem, and in all Judea, and in Samaria, and to the uttermost part of the earth. Now that Jesus Christ had given them that promise, what were they doing? Look at verse 14. These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication. They continued in prayer and supplication with the women, and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and his brethren. It was in that attitude of prayer, it was in that place of prayer, it was in that continuity in prayer, that when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place. Chapter 2, verse 1, verse 2. Now, and suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind, and it filled all the house where they were sitting. And there appeared unto them cloven tongues like as of fire, and sat on each of them, and they were all filled. Thank God you'll be filled. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and began to speak or talk as the Spirit gave them utterance. Look at chapter 4, verse 31. Increase your prayer and supplication. Chapter 4 of Acts, verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaking when they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost and speak the word of God with boldness. You see that evidence of the Holy Ghost coming in. They were not timid anymore, not fearful anymore, not afraid of anything, anyone anymore. When the Holy Ghost came in, it says they speak the word of God with boldness. D, what does D stand for? Tell me the whole thing. And then R, what does R stand for? And I, what does I stand for? N, neglect not the promise of a sanctifier. Neglect not. Don't neglect the promise of our sanctifier. We're told in 1 Timothy chapter 4 verse 14. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm reading here from verse 14. 1 Timothy chapter 4. I'm reading from verse 14. Neglect not the gift. Neglect. This is the gift of the Spirit. And this is the spiritual thing. Neglect not the Greek gift that is in thee, which was given thee by prophecy with the laying on of the hands of the presbytery. It says, meditate upon these things and give thyself wholly to them, that thy prophecy may appear unto all. In our own case, the Lord has given us the promise. He has said, he will baptize us, he will fill us, he will immerse us, he will energize us with the power of the Holy Ghost. You will not neglect that promise. So be reminding the Lord while you are praying, this is what you promised. You said you will do it. Do as you have said, and I will do it in Jesus' name. Luke chapter 24, verse 49. Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, verse 20, verse 49. And behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you. That's the promise he has given us. He said, behold, I send the promise of my Father upon you, but tarry ye in the city of Jerusalem until ye be endued with power from on high. Power is coming upon you. In your soul, in your spirit, in your mind, in your life, that power will energize you in Jesus' name. D, desire the power of the Spirit. R, renew the purity in true sanctification. I, increase your prayer and supplication. N, neglect not the promise of a sanctifier. K, keep your passion for his service. Keep your passion for his service. You know why he's giving us the Holy Ghost? So as to preach, so as to work, so as to win souls, so as to serve him. And so as you are receiving the Holy Spirit and you're saying, God, I come and I want to receive this. What do you want to receive the Holy Ghost for? For exactly the same purpose, the Son of God, Jesus Christ, has given us this promise. And keep that passion. Keep your passion for his service. Acts chapter 1 verse 8, but ye shall receive power after the Holy Ghost has come upon you, and ye shall be witnesses unto me, both in Jerusalem and in all Judea, and in all Samaria, and in Samaria, and unto the uttermost part of the earth. Keep that passion. Keep that passion. I want to use this to serve the Lord. The gift, the power, the knowledge, the understanding, the revelation. I want to use that to serve the Lord. Keep your passion for his service. Acts chapter 4, verse 31. Acts chapter 4 verse 31. And when they had prayed, the place was shaking where they were assembled together. And they were all filled with the Holy Ghost. And they speak the word. That's the service. And they speak the word. That's the purpose. And they speak the word. That's the reason the Holy Ghost came unto them. They got it and they kept the passion for his service. And they speak the word with his boldness. That boldness is coming. Look at chapter 5, verse 4, chapter 5, verse 32. Chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 32. Chapter 5, verse 32, it says, and we are his witnesses of these things, and so also is the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to them that obey him. Has given to them that obey him. Go into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. And they were obeying that they kept the passion for his service. Look at verse 42. In verse 42, and daily in the temple and in every house they ceased not to teach and to preach Jesus Christ. That's the reason the Holy Ghost was given. And it continued just like that. Chapter 8, and I'm reading from verse 4. Chapter 8, we're reading from verse 4. Therefore, they that were scattered abroad went everywhere preaching the word of God. Preaching the word. We're soon going back home, and everywhere we go, we'll be preaching the word. We'll be serving the Lord. The Holy Ghost is coming upon our lives. Is coming in a baptismal measure, in a greater measure than we ever received before. And the reason is to keep on serving the Lord. And thank God I see people who are soul winners here tonight. I see ministers of God there tonight. And I see the people who are passionate in the service of the Lord tonight. And I pray that this work of the Lord will prosper in your hands, in our hands together in Jesus' name. In the last day, that great day of the feast, Jesus stood and cried, saying, if any man thirst, if any man thirst, if any man thirst, let him come unto me and drink. This is your time now. This is your opportunity now. He says, if you are thirsty, and thank God you are thirsty. And thank God you are desirous. It says you can come and drink. He that believeth on me, as the scripture has said, out of his belly shall flow rivers of living water. But this speak ye of the Holy Spirit, which they that believe on him shall receive. You will receive. I will receive. I said I will receive. What are you now? I will receive. Why don't you stand up and tell the Lord, I will receive. For the Holy Ghost was not yet given for, because Jesus was not yet glorified. Now he is glorified. And now he is telling us you can come to him. And you can ask of him. And you can drink. There must be desire. And then there must be the renewal in your heart. And there must be the increase in prayer and supplication. You must not neglect the promises he has given unto us. And then you keep the passion for his service. Open your mouth and tell the Lord, ask and shall be given you. Seek and ye shall find. And knock it shall be open unto you. Everyone that asketh receiveth. He that seeketh findeth. And to him that knocketh it shall be open. What man is there of you? If his son shall ask him bread, will you give him a stone? Or if he shall ask a fish, will you give him scorpion? If ye then being evil not to give good things to your children, how much more? How much more? How much more shall your Father who is in heaven give the Holy Spirit to them that ask him? Ask and receive.